our debt is towards two state banks, namely Bank of Ceylon and People's Bank. The total debt is in the tune of $3.6 billion, and we are not proud, but ashamed to say that we are the biggest borrower in the country. Of course, CPC is the largest institute in the country. There is no private company as large as the Petroleum Corporation. Our annual turnover is around 700 billion rupees. So, unfortunately, we have debt to the tune of $3.6 billion. In a commercial venture, the management has the right to mark cost reflective prices. But here, prices are determined by the cabinet ministers, therefore by the cabinet. Therefore, it's very difficult to arrange a plan because our debt is rapidly increasing since our selling prices do not reflect the actual cost incurred to us. At this moment, we are selling our products at excessively low prices. In addition to that, we are supplying kerosene considering the requirement of the fishing community as well as the rural community. Our cost is around 100 rupees per liter, kerosene liter, but we are selling at 77 rupees. Then we are selling furnace oil to electricity producers, mainly the CEB and other private power producers, at 70 rupees, although our cost is 110 rupees. We are, for every single liter, we are losing 40 rupees. On the other hand, we are selling at an extremely low price. On the other hand, we do not receive even that amount. The electricity board is in debt to us for 89 billion rupees. Similarly, Sri Lankan Airlines is in debt to us for 67 billion rupees. Although they do not pay those amounts, we do pay interest to two state banks at 5.5%. Unless the government has no capacity to subsidize the CPC, it should be permitted to mark cost reflective prices. Otherwise, CPC would collapse, resulting two state banks would collapse, resulting entire economy would collapse. We don't want that to happen. That's why we demand the government to either give us a subsidy or allow us to sell at cost reflective prices. Well, price formula practiced by the previous government is something can be seen in developed countries, because when prices are going up, there will be two issues. You know, if we change the prices frequently, these have two negative impacts. Firstly, when there are sudden higher price increases, if there are sudden prices in the fuel prices, there will be a huge impact on cost of living, which cannot be borne by the poor segment of the society. That is not an issue in the first world, or rather in the developed countries. Secondly, when our prices, if the fuel prices fluctuate frequently, our exporters are not in a position to submit a quotation with confidence, because by the time he has to submit the product, their quotation may not be valid because of the change in fuel prices. Because of that, I have recommended the cabinet to establish a fuel price stabilization fund, which would be more suitable for a country like Sri Lanka than a price formula. I submitted this proposal in 15th March this year. This has been deliberating at a cabinet subcommittee for quite some time, And the committee report is to be deliberated at the next meeting of the cabinet coming Monday. Cabinet has given its nod to sign this agreement, so it's a matter of signing now. Lawyers of the two sides are deliberating the legal clauses of the agreement at this moment. This agreement is quite crucial, as you know, because of the pandemic, there is a huge pressure on our balance of payment since we lost three major foreign currency inflows because of the pandemic. Firstly, tourism, around $4 billion. Remittance from the expatriate workers, around $8 billion. Then foreign investment, around $2 to $3 billion. So there was a gap between export income and import expenditure, around $8 billion. This gap was bridged with inflows from those three sources. But as you know, those sources have dried up or drastically come down. As a result, we are in a foreign currency crisis at the moment. I am the first minister to announce this crisis to the country in June this year. If we can secure this loan, we can infuse $300 million to our forex market on monthly basis for a year. That would soothe the present crisis, and people will get the ultimate benefit. We can control the inflation driven by import cost, driven by the ever appreciating dollar. Secondly, we can ensure that with great difficulty, I ensured the uninterrupted fuel supply. This is the most attractive, Omani one is the most attractive credit facility. There are several such credit facilities in the pipeline. Then there are four such credit facilities in the pipeline. If this one fails, we can go for other alternatives. In 2003, the present opposition was in power, and they have handed over entire oil tank farm in Trincomalee to India for 35 years. This contract will end in 2038. Unfortunately, the very same opposition are now alleging me that I am in an attempt to sell these tanks to India. How can I give this tank to India when it has already been given by a previous government? I have only one task, that is to take those tanks back. When I was appointed as the Minister of Energy, it has been mentioned as one of my priorities in the President's Gazette notification, which has name as duties and functions of the ministers. Most of the Indo-Sri Lankan agreements have been in favor of India, except two. Those are Sirima Sastri Pact of 1964 and Sirima Gandhi Pact of 1974. It's also known as Kachchatiw Pact. Since I studied the politics of those two pacts in depth, I was able to negotiate with India to sign a contract which is very much favor in Sri Lanka. I am a close follower of Indo-Sri Lanka relations. In fact, my PhD thesis will also be based on Indo-Sri Lanka relations. So my conclusion is that India supported Tamil militants and forced Sri Lanka to sign Indo-Lanka Accord, not because of anything else, but because of Trincomalee Oil Tank Farm. It has more national security value than a commercial value. There are 100 tanks which can store 1 million metric tons of fuel. If another nation invades India or attacks in India, that country will first attempt to secure the control of Trincomalee, because then they can have uninterrupted fuel supply for their ships and warships and planes in the close proximity. That is why India is very sensitive about these tanks and forced Sri Lanka to agree with India to jointly develop these tanks in Indo-Lanka Accord of 1987. Unfortunately, Sri Lanka doesn't have a foreign agreement policy or international trade policy, national security policy. You know, when you are going to vet something, there must be yardsticks to measure whether this is good or bad. Unless we have our policies, then principles based on policies, only we can evaluate an agreement whether it is in our favor or not. When previous government signed with a trade agreement with Singapore, we bitterly criticized and forced the government to formulate a national trade policy to evaluate any trade agreement to determine whether it's in our favor or not. Unfortunately, that government didn't do that. Our present trade minister is in the process of formulating a national trade policy. Likewise, we should have a national security policy. Then we can evaluate these agreements and can come to a conclusion whether this is in our favor or not. According to our seismic data, Manna Basin alone, because we have three basins, let me technically explain this for better understanding of the people. Sri Lankan surrounding have been classified into three basins. Now in this picture, this area, we have the shallow water, less than 150 meters, the depth is less than 150 meters. So this area is known as Cauvery Basin. This blue area, depth is 150 to 3000 meters. This is known as Manna Basin. The rest is more than 3000 meters in depth. That area is known as Lanka Basin. At this moment, we have only seismic data for Manna Basin with American company called Belgio Space. We are conducting a magnetic survey to collect data in respect of Cauvery Basin. So, in Manna Basin, we have identified gas potential of 9 trillion cubic feet. Market value, then in addition to that, we have identified crude oil potential of 2 billion barrels. The collective market value is, with the current prices, is approximately $280 billion. You know, we have been having these gas and oil deposits for millions of years, but so far we failed to mine those resources and monetize. Why? Soon after I became the minister, my petroleum secretariat brought me a plan for auctioning these blocks. I said no, because once Albert Einstein said that if you repeat the same test under the same conditions, expecting a different result, you are insane. I don't want to look like insane. So I said, we must find the reason for the failures of the previous attempts. Without rectifying those failures, we should not go for another auction. Otherwise, we would end up with the same result. Then I talked to the big market giants and asked them, why don't you come to Sri Lanka? they explain 8 weaknesses in Sri Lankan petroleum industry. Then certain cases we were able to do at the administrative level, like we appointed 2 industry experts as the for the top post of the secretariat, because when the investors come here to invest around $3 to $5 billion, huge income, huge investment. We never had such a huge investment in Sri Lanka in our entire history. So when there are no single person in the secretariat who can understand their technical language, they will not get confidence to dump such a huge money in Sri Lanka. Then we have only 20 blocks. It will take huge time period if they secure one block to explore and collect their data. Then I re-demarcated the blocks, converting those 20 into 873 small blocks. For other issues, I introduced a new act in Parliament on October 6th, which is known as Petroleum Development Act. With that, we have introduced a Petroleum Development Authority, and I transferred all of my regulatory authorities to the Petroleum Development Authority, because one concern of the potential investor is that regulatory powers are centered around one person. He is also a politician. Then administrative decisions were taken by a committee of ministerial secretaries. They don't have an in-depth understanding about the petroleum industry. Therefore, I abolish it and establish a board of directors who have some connection to petroleum industry. Then I introduce a fiscal policy and legal framework to secure giant investment to be brought by the potential investors. Then I demarcated the boundaries of the regulator, policymaker, and the operator. Now, policymaker would be the minister, regulator would be the Petroleum Development Authority, and in order to conduct exploration and mining activities, we are going to establish a new company called National Oil and Gas Company of Sri Lanka. I visited Gas Tech Conference and I explained our ambitious plan for monetizing our gas and petroleum resources. Then I talked to the ministers of Oman, Azerbaijan, Iran, and UAE in respect of exploration in Sri Lanka. Then market giants such as ExxonMobil, Total. We made lot of contacts. We have already made lot of contacts. They are also very much interested. Even recently, one market giant purchased our data pack, spending $10 million. Industry is looking bullish. I'm very positive about it. I said we are going to have a company called National Oil and Gas Company of Sri Lanka. Whoever who come to invest in Sri Lanka should allow this national operator to take shares up to 15%, and the operator will have at least one board seat. So we will get an income for these 15% shares, and in addition to that, we will gain experience by working in those companies. Then on a future date, our national operator will be able to conduct exploration and exploitation independently. That's how Petronas of Malaysia develop. There will be a signature bonuses, royalty, then taxes. Those are we have not predetermined. It all depends on the reserves that we are going to have and how costly those are. As the Minister of Energy, it was my duty to inform the cabinet possible complications and impact of adverse impact of this agreement. So I submitted my observations twice to the cabinet, explaining the jeopardy that may cause by this agreement. When there was a tender going on for this project, if the government offer the project to a non-participatory company, there will be a good governance issue. Secondly, there is a diplomatic issue. Previous government had signed MOUs with South Korea, Japan and India to offer them to conduct this project. Since we can't offer a project for three different countries, we decided to go for calling open tenders. China was able to secure the tender. Now, when we offer this project to the USA, all China, India, South Korea and Japan will be upset with Sri Lanka. Thirdly, there is an energy security issue. Energy security as well as national security issue. As you know, USA has been interfering with Sri Lankan internal affairs for last 40 years. When we offer them the monopoly of gas supply to our power sector, they can influence decisions of Sri Lankan government with the threat of stopping supply of gas. Fourthly, it will have an adverse impact on attracting investors for our gas mining. Not really. The agreement ISO was more dangerous than that. They will have the monopoly for 5 years, but the termination will take place only when CEB has a pipeline of their own. When, as far as I could see, there can't be another pipeline once a New Fortress Energy laid their pipeline. Then there will be no replacement pipeline of the CEB would materialize in the future. There is no possibility of materializing a new replacement pipeline by the CEB. In other words, this contract is forever or indefinitely. Why should we wait for another government? I think our government should review the agreement for the national interest. Let's say for the sake of national interest.